Wow. Wow, really? For me? You shouldn't have. Hi. Thank you for that. That was amazing. Welcome to On the Verge. I'm Josh Topolsky. I'm the editor-in-chief of TheVerge.com. It's a website you maybe have heard of. And I would love to thank you guys for being here. This is our second show. And we've made it to the end of the year together as a family. And I think that's very exciting. This is a big show. We're really stoked about it. We've got an amazing guest. John Gruber is here from Daring Fireball. I thought that might be a mixture of booze and cheering, but you guys were really polite. That's nice. Joanna Stern is here. She's going to do some cool stuff. We have a bunch of segments for you guys. Nilay and Paul are here. There may be some giveaways. It's going to be a lot of fun. We also have our house band, Trent. Yeah, according to the census, he's now an entire band. It's pretty amazing. It's pretty fantastic. I wanted to say thanks to Sony. They're sponsoring this show. So give a round of applause to Sony, because we wouldn't be here. None of us would be here in America if it weren't for Sony. But it's true. It's a fact. But, you know, our first guest, I'm going to bring him out in a second. But I wanted to say that, you know, Apple has obviously been that company has been a huge topic of conversation for the past few months. Steve Jobs passed away recently, as all of you know, I'm sure. And that's on top of, you know, the new iPhone and iOS 5 and all the controversy with Samsung and other companies about patents. I was really excited about getting John here to talk about this stuff, because I feel like you may agree with him or disagree with him, but he's got a definite opinion about the company, and I think he's got a lot of insight. So I'm excited to have this conversation. So I think we should just get him out here. Please welcome John Gruber. You made it. Wonderful.
Nice introduction.
Watch your step. How's that feeling?
It's great.
Is that good? Watch that arm. It's a little broken. I think this is going to be our thing where I warn people about the arm. I don't ever want to fix that. It gives me an icebreaker. Isn't this nice? We got, John requested that, he asked for a mug.
Yeah.
And we couldn't find mugs, so we have plastic cups. I think this is,
But if you ask for an Android tablet, they've got like
plenty of Android tablets here. Was that annoying to you to see those? Did that bother you?
No, it doesn't bother me.
So John, before we get into talking about the industry that we both write about, I want to talk about John Gruber, the man. I want to get to know you intimately. Are you?
I thought you said the couch is broken.
Are you? And I think you know how it got broken. Where did you come from? Where did John Gruber come from? I mean, Daring Fireball is a massive, like, as far as sites that people are either, man, I hate that and I have to read it every day, or I love that and I have to read it every day. You're way up there in our space. People love Daring Fireball. They love you. So tell me where Daring Fireball came from, where you came from, and how this phenomenon began.
I don't know. I don't think I have a good sense of that.
That's a terrible answer.
No, but what I mean, though, is that when I started the site in 2002. We could go back further than that, but
let's go back further.
Well, I went to college in the 90s. I worked on this student newspaper at Drexel University. I thought, you know, writing is what I like to do. I studied computer science, but I spent all my time at the newspaper, and that was the direction I wanted to go. But didn't really pursue it. And it just seemed like all the jobs you could get, like, what do you have to do? Go to journalism school and get more school, and then you get a job covering, I don't know, local politics at a newspaper. And none of it seemed like something I wanted to do. So I just built websites and did other stuff. But I always had in mind that writing was what I wanted to do. But then, you know, a couple of years go by and I realize, you know, hadn't done any writing. And it's like, hey, time's moving on. But I somehow, in my mind, I felt like I was still getting better at it. And I couldn't really think about why. And this is maybe 2001 or so. And at the time, I was working for Barebone Software, the people who make BB Edit. At the time, they had a mail client for the Mac called Mailsmith. And a customer asked on a mailing list for the is there a way that I could figure out to get a word count for all the email that I've written, you know, with Mailsmith? And I thought, well, that's a neat little thing. I'll do that for him. and I ran it against my own thing, and I figured out how much email I had written over the last couple of years, and it was this huge number. I forget what it was, and I thought, wow. And then I like Googled like, what's the average word count of a book? And it was I don't forget exactly how.
I think it's 50,000.
Yeah, something average. Like that. But yeah. It ended up that I just through email I had written mailing lists and stuff like that. I had written like 3 or 4 books worth of email, and I thought, well, that's why I feel like
not I'm, a narrative though.
No, not like one single thing.
Your people are like, well, I don't understand this email.
And at this...
Chapter 4, I don't get this, John.
Right. So at the same time, I was following other people who had personal weblogs, people like Jason Kotke, you know, there were others. And I thought, you know, I could do that. Because the thing I always wanted to do is, in a newspaper parlance or magazine parlance, is I didn't want to be a reporter, I wanted to be the columnist.
Yeah.
I wanted to be the guy on the back page, you know? I wanted to be the guy on the ed-op page who just gets to say what he thinks.
Like the cranky...
Well, I just want, you know,
it's a cranky role, though, right?
It can be. You know, it could be funny. You know, you could be like a Dave Barry type, you know, but you have personality. You're not,
right.
You're not writing from this pseudo-objective voice of the newspaper. You're writing from your own voice. And again, like I said, the way it looked, though, to me, though, is to get those cool columnist jobs, you had to put in, like, 20 years as a crap reporter. And that just didn't appeal to me. But then I saw these with weblogs. I thought, well, you could just skip that and just go right to being a columnist. And that, to me, is how I've always seen Daring Fireball, is, like, my column on the stuff that I'm interested in. You know, it took me a couple years to get it off the ground. You know, I thought about it for a while and just started writing.
So do you think of yourself as a blogger? I mean, are you a journalist? Are you a blogger? What is your role right now?
See, I don't know. I don't know what that means. To me,
well, I mean, a blogger, I think, or let's say a columnist, right? Like you said,
right.
You could voice your opinions. You don't have to. You're not necessarily responsible for delivering news to people, right?
No.
Right. You're not breaking news stories, though. You do break news stories.
Right. But I don't have to. Like I never feel obligated to cover anything.
Right. And you don't really cover that. I mean, you write about your observations from things,
right.
Or about things. So, but you don't. Do you not consider yourself a blogger? I mean, is that not the right term for you?
I honestly don't know what that means. Because to me, a blog is a medium, not a verb. Like I write. I mean, to me, I'm just a writer.
Right.
And it could apply to anything that needs to be written. It could work in a newspaper. I could write stuff that is read on a television show. I mean, it's writing.
So new columnist is kind of new,
yeah.
Like NU with umlauts,
right.
Columnist.
Right.
So that's interesting. I mean, so you don't identify with like the, if you know, if there's a blogger uproar or something, you don't go like, hey, I'm one of these guys.
No, although I do identify with the independent media, you know, and I think you're clearly part of that too. I mean, I think that's, you know, I mean, obviously The Verge is a larger headcount operation than Daring Fireball, but it's
Daring
still,
Fireball is just you, right?
It is just me.
So we are slightly larger.
Right. But I think it's still of a piece, though. It is the idea that, I still think, even though you're big compared to me, but it's still, I think, a very lean and mean operation where pretty much everybody you're hiring is doing something that's actually like readers and viewers get to see and read and feel and touch.
Yeah.
Whereas newspapers and magazines and TV networks over the last, you know, decades of the 20th century grew into these huge conglomerates with massive, massive internal bureaucracies and structures and all sorts of people doing all sorts of things, and a focus on the content just got lost. And
yeah.
So I definitely identify with that, but it doesn't have to be, you know, the word blog or the verb blogging.
Right. But when people ask you, just say, I'm a writer.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're not just like you're not just covering all aspects of technology. I mean, you have a definite focus, right? And I mean, you focus on Apple primarily.
I do, but you know, it was like a conscious decision not to name the site, you know, Daring MacBall or.
Yeah. What is Daring? What are the origins of the phrase Daring Fireball?
It just sounded cool.
That's it?
Yeah.
You were sitting down trying to figure it out, and you just thought Daring Fireball, those words.
Well, I
thought
of it many years before, and then I just thought, you know, I'll keep that and use that later.
You just popped into your head, Daring Fireball.
Right.
Was it part of an email?
No. It was just, I didn't tell anybody. I didn't want anybody to steal it.
So, but you do write a lot about Apple.
Right.
And is that something, have you always been an Apple? I mean, did you start, you know, your first computer was an Apple, and you've been like kind of into the company since the...
it always appealed to me. I mean, I didn't have a computer, though, in the house growing up. The only thing we had like Atari, but my parents wouldn't buy me a computer on the grounds that if they did, they said I'd never leave the house.
And were they right?
Yeah, I think they were. I actually think they were right. It was very frustrating to me at the time, but I think in hindsight they were right. Like I think I did more socially than
right.
I would have otherwise.
But then you ended up getting the computer
and then never
going back in the house.
Right.
So it was all for naught.
Yeah, really. I haven't left the house since October.
That's amazing. Is that true?
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah, I mean, I was actually saying before the show, but we have only ever spoken in person at Apple events.
That
so
is
this
true.
Is the first time outside of an Apple event that you and I are communicating face to face.
I believe so.
Is that exciting to you?
It's very exciting.
It's exciting to me as well. So I think you've got a very special relationship when it comes to Apple. You are considered kind of a fanboy, an Apple fanboy. Would you say that's accurate? I'm not saying that the term is fair, but people do consider you to be a bit of a fanboy.
Yeah, but I think that that's, I honestly, and I don't use that word to describe anybody who is a fan of anything. What's my quip on that? It's that...
You have a prepared statement.
I forget. I know what it was. It was when Mark Cuban switched to a Mac, and this was a while back, maybe like 2004, 2005, but he wrote a blog post about it. Mark Cuban, the owner of the Dallas Mavericks, billionaire, sold some piece of junk to Yahoo in the 90s.
Mark, I think people know Mark All right. Cuban. Also, a great guest star on Entourage.
Yes, yeah.
But anyway, really good actor.
Mark Cuban had this thing about switching to a Mac and that, man, this is great. I can't believe it. This is so great. I'm no Mac fan. I'm no Apple fanboy, but you know, this is the way to go now. And then I realized that what Apple fanboy meant was somebody who began using Apple products before you did.
Oh, yeah.
So in that
but
sense,
but now it means something else, so don't you think?
Well, I think there are people who, you know, the accusation is that I blindly say good things about Apple products and figure out ways that actions Apple takes are good ideas or smart or whatever because I'm rooting for them, like they're my sports team.
Yeah, not blindly, but I think you do.
Well, but I think that's what the word fanboy implies.
Right, that but you are rooting for Apple.
Only in the sense that I appreciate that what they're trying to do, and I'm glad that somebody is doing it, and if it were not for Apple, the industry would be in a far different state. I mean, I think, when the iPod came out, the first iPod MP3 player, you didn't see a rash of copycat products from other companies. You didn't see other people do that. People didn't get it. And it took a long time also for it to become a big seller. Like it was, you know, that's the one thing people forget. Everybody knows the iPod was a big hit for Apple and kind of turned the whole company around. But it was a Mac-only product for a year and a half. It required FireWire, which people with Windows PCs didn't even have
FireWire.
A FireWire port. Whereas now, Apple comes out with, say, the iPad, and how long did it take before things that looked an awful lot like an iPad started coming out from other companies?
A year, a year and a half, maybe? A year?
Pretty much, yeah.
I mean, so you're saying that you're a fan of what they do,
right?
Because they do it better than a lot of other people, and they're an industry leader. And I don't disagree with you. They do lead the industry in a lot of ways. I think the thing that where people would take issue is there are times it seems, and I read your site every day. Big fan of your work. But there are times when it seems like you'll take a review. Like I can't remember. I think one of our guys did a review recently. It was a pretty positive review about a non-Apple product. And you'll find the one negative line
right.
from the review, right? Like an Android, you know, somebody reviews an Android phone, they're like, it's great. You know, the launcher was a little sluggish.
Right.
Right. And you know, it's like the launcher was a little sluggish. It's like so and so on whatever this Android phone is. The launcher was a little sluggish, and you're like, glad I'm not buying this thing. if you're a Daring Fireball reader, your exposure to that review is literally like, this piece of crap I would not touch with a 10-foot pole. I mean, you definitely don't do that with Apple products.
I don't think, though, that there are... I think the things that I focus on, and I'm cognizant of that. I don't think, though, I try to, if I do that, I try to pick things that, to me, exemplify major differences. A recent one, I think just this week, was somebody on The Verge reviewed some piece of crap LG Android phone.
I think this is the Nitro.
Right, the Nitro.
But it was actually like a fairly positive review. I mean, it wasn't a complete piece of crap.
Right. But what I thought was interesting was the part when he got to the LTE, which is 4G, real 4G, no ifs, ands, or buts about it, no quotes around it, and really fast. It's getting like 15, 16 megabits per second up and down,
yeah,
which blows away anything, you know, an Apple 3G product can do, but at the expense of significant battery drain.
Right.
And you can't turn it off. You can't say, I don't want to use LTE, I want to use 3G. And so, yes, that's the part I quoted from the review. But to me, that's because it shows that Apple is a company with a very different philosophy towards these products.
Right.
Like, at Apple...
But you see that view, you're looking at it from, like, as an Apple versus that thing, right? You're not looking at that product in a vacuum. And by
right.
the way,
that is
as
true.
A columnist, I think this is, like, what you should be doing.
Right.
Because you've got your beat. And your beat is talking about Apple as it relates to the rest of the industry. And I like it most of the time. But I do think you can see how people would get there. I mean, you have some people who really, you get under their skin.
I guess. I'm not really all that aware of it, though. I really am not.
Have you
not.
Been on the internet? I know you don't have comments, so that's actually kind of, it helps, right? You have no comments on your site.
Right.
So you're kind of less exposed to that.
Right, but even on places where there are, like I will often read through like the Hacker News comments on when of something that I've written. And, you know, obviously there's some people who you know, seem to not be a fan of my work or think that I'm biased and it's worthless because if I say something that's good about an Apple product, it doesn't count. Because of course John Gruber is going to say that.
Yeah, of course.
But I don't know. I mean, if there's you can find people who will say anything. I have no idea what kind of a number that is. I really don't.
But you actually say negative stuff too. I mean, you just wrote something pretty negative about Siri. You were talking about how you felt that Siri was, well, it's not that great.
Well, it's half baked. I mean, it is beta. I mean, they're right to call it beta, and it's unusual. It's very unusual. In fact, I can't think of another example where Apple both released something that's clearly should be called beta, and they're highly touting it.
That's the selling point of the iPhone 4S is Siri at this point.
Right. And then I said, but I'm glad it's there. I think the phone is better for it. I use it. I find it to be very useful. I think, you know, I think they made the right move. And maybe it's Siri's a unique case because the way that they're doing the cloud-based voice recognition, and they need to collect all that, and collectively by getting all that, it's making the accuracy better. You know, and that's
right.
And I even got emails from people who do AI, you know, like real AI research, is saying, yeah, you know, no amount of data is too much data
right.
for this sort of thing.
They're trying to make the service better
right.
by getting lots
but
of data.
But it is
now.
Unusual. No, but my thing is that all I want to be, the only thing I'm obsessed with is being right all the time. And it's honestly.
But you do agree that in certain cases there can be, you know, varying degrees of right. Right?
No, you're either right or you're wrong.
Well, I mean, the battery life to you is like, this is wrong.
Oh, well,
like, this
no,
is
that's
bad,
different.
Right?
You know, well, let me get back to that.
Okay.
All I'm obsessed with is being right. And so the way I look at it is I look back at, like, the last 9 years I've been writing on Daring Fireball. And most of what I've written about Apple has been very positive. Most of what I've written about their products have been positive. And when I have conjectured as to how I think things are going to go for the company, for the most part, I have said I think they're going to keep succeeding in these areas. I look back at the last 9 years, and I think I was almost always right.
Do you have you calculated on a percentage basis? Something
no.
tells me you may have.
No,
at least,
I don't.
But you've thought about it, right?
Right. And I know the times.
You've considered getting out,
right.
You know, some charts and graphs on
and this. And I know the times, you know, the times that I have been wrong, they kill me.
Sure, I feel the same way. And in fact, you and I have had rather public disagreements about stuff that I've gotten wrong, and
right.
you were kind of like, you're wrong, because that's obviously
so
pleasing
only,
to you.
It is never going to...
to tell someone that they're wrong.
Right.
You have to admit you do a delight in telling someone that they're wrong.
I do.
Because it also means you get to be right in that moment.
Exactly. It's a personal weakness that I do take delight in pointing out when others are wrong.
Yeah.
And I, You know what? And I look back, and I did. I look back on that one, the 11th hour one.
Yeah.
And it was a little, it was unnecessarily mean at the
we
end.
Should, we actually, let's talk about this for one quick second, because then I have other stuff on it. But a long time ago when I was at Engadget, I had heard some stuff about the iPad 2 from a source that was pretty tested.
A long time ago. That's like 11 months.
Well, it was a lot. In our world, hey, a lot has happened in 11 months. I mean, a lot has happened in 11 months. We're going to get some of that. But so I said, look, it's going to have, I forget what it was, higher resolution screen and like this SD slot, which the person I had spoken to was thought this is going to happen. And that person had been dead on with other things that you know of. Anyhow, we had a big conversation. You kind of called me out and said, this is BS.
Right.
This is 11th hour. 11th hour, my ass, I believe, was your expression.
Right.
And because I said it had happened in the 11th hour. But we saw each other at that event for the iPad 2, and we talked. And I said, look, there have been other times that Apple has pulled something at the last minute, and the iPod Touch camera was one of the things that I mentioned.
Right.
And you agreed.
Right, but I actually looked
to
it
me.
Up. I looked it up after our rehearsal, and I went back, and I actually mentioned that in that 11th hour post that, yes, Apple does change things at the 11th hour. So I actually did mention that.
Right, but you're still like, they're totally wrong. This is not possible.
Right. Well,
but even though you said it was, it clearly was.
That was, it's just a unique case,
I'm very
though.
Hurt about you this. Had I'm a, not going to let this go.
You had a good source in January who you trusted and said it was a high resolution, but I had a golden source in January. And so I knew it was
well,
wrong.
You, and you were like, right.
Right.
And you were right.
And I will just say, though, if you think about it, common sense-wise, if you think about it, with the iPod Touch 2 years ago.
Are we arguing this now?
Well, we'll just do it real quick.
I admit that you're right.
They hadn't had a camera on it yet. And they had one that was going to have a camera. And then literally, like, at the last possible minute, they could make such a change. I still don't. I've never heard why. You know? But for some reason, they said, you know what? No camera. And all they did was retool the silver back to get rid of the camera hole. And boom, they start popping off the factory line. And then when the iFixit guys pop it open, lo, there's a little spot for where the camera was supposed to be.
But you would agree that was an 11th hour change.
Yes, but that's the sort of thing you could do at the last minute, is
well, I think
change the back to not have a hole in it.
Yeah.
Whereas switching from iPad 1 resolution, pixel resolution display to the double resolution one.
Well, I think maybe then it's a question of what you consider to be the 11th hour.
Right.
Right? Because my report was way before the announcement.
No, but you like doubled down on it on January 14th.
I did double down. That's right. Did I double down?
I think you
did. Are you sure?
Yeah.
I thought that the January 14th report was, that was right before it was announced.
Right.
It was like, it's not going to happen. That was the
I
report.
Don't remember.
Yeah,
maybe,
because your 11th hour post was in response to me saying, because this did happen. You were like, this is BS. But I talked to the same source. They said, you know what? It isn't happening. They're not going to do the screen. They're not going to do the SD. And then you were very upset about that.
Well, yeah, because
I was going to end up being right.
No,
after
because
all.
I know that the iPad 2 was never going to have a Retina display.
So talk. Let's. You were right about that. I'll give you that. And I've been ruining that prediction ever since. But. So you said you had a golden source. So let's talk about your relationship with Apple, because you have a relationship with Apple, and in fact I don't know what your relationship was like with Steve Jobs, and I do want to talk about the post Apple Jobs, but I know that you guys have talked at least one time. I was like standing off to the side, I think maybe when you met him. I don't know if you had met him before this. I think it was maybe the iPhone 4 after the iPhone 4 announcement.
Right.
Was that the first time? Was that the first time you met him?
That was.
So I was standing like off doing some photographs or something, and I saw Jobs come over and be introduced to you. And of course,
No. Jobs doesn't come over to you.
He was brought. Oh, you were
they
brought
say,
over.
Yeah, they say, would you like to meet Steve?
Right.
And then you're like,
you were brought to
Duh.
Him. There was some. There was somebody drifted in one direction or the other.
Katie Cotton asked me if I wanted to meet him, and I actually said to her, I said, has anybody ever said no to that? And she said no.
Right. And I saw you guys rapping a little bit. Did that relationship go beyond that? I mean, did you email with each other? Did you ever have any?
No.
Because Jobs actually cited you as a response to what was this over? Was this Flash or it was either the dev tools when they kind of banned third party dev tools?
Yeah, something to do with Flash. Though.
And you had written a big. I don't know if you guys remember this, but there was a lot of controversy about the App Store and the kind of tools you could use, or Flash. It was one of these, one of their controversies about things we don't want on the iPhone.
Right.
And you had written a big piece on Daring Fireball.
Right.
And Jobs said, go read Daring Fireball's post on this, because we think this sums it up perfectly.
We think John Gruber's take on this is insightful and not negative.
Is that what he said?
Yeah.
How was the traffic on that
post? It was crazy. I mean, it really was. It's by far and away the most trafficked post. And all it was is one of those things where some random guy emailed Steve Jobs, some other guy, like a developer, you know, somebody nobody had heard of.
Right.
Had emailed Steve Jobs, and Steve Jobs just wrote back this one line, we think John Gruber's take is insightful and not negative. And that was it.
He responded in an email.
And then the guy who did that got the email and did, you know, where some people would get emails from Steve Jobs and then put it on their weblog and say, Steve Jobs sent me email, and everybody goes nuts. It's at the top of tech meme, you know, the next day.
Yeah, that happened.
Yeah, so it's like second or third hand, though. It's some random guy's site, you know, which never got big traffic.
I mean, you should have just been sending out those emails as Steve Jobs.
It was easily like a 25% bump. Like, you know, like if you look back at like my month-to-month stats, it was easily like 25, 30% higher than the month before.
So let's talk about Apple now. Steve Jobs, I mean, clearly based on what everybody says and I think what we've seen over the last however many years, I mean, since he's been back at Apple, it does seem that he was... if not the sole person responsible for many of these amazing devices, the iPad, the iPhone, he was a real driving force, right? I mean, he was putting pieces together that other people weren't putting together. Do you agree or disagree with that?
Yeah, definitely. I think he saw the world differently, and I don't think any of us, you know, can really understand that, especially, you know, where he saw technology going. And he was right about a lot of things. He really was. I mean, and sometimes it's arrogant, and obviously he had this binary view of everything was either can we swear?
Sure.
All right. Everything was either shit or the best thing ever. Right? This is total shit or it's the best thing ever, and there was like no ground in between.
It was like somebody's great or they're a bozo that's blowing it.
Right. And so like for example, like when he said in 2007 at the iPhone introduction that we're 5 years ahead of everybody else. I was blown away. I was in the audience, and I still it was that one.
Were there tears?
No, joy. No tears. But it was the one.
Was anybody there near you crying?
No. But people were having fits.
Right.
I mean,
no. It's a really good intro.
Yeah.
If anybody here has not seen Steve Jobs introducing the first iPhone, it is kind of amazing.
Yeah.
If you want to see how to introduce a product, this is like it may never get better than that moment.
It's the one product introduction that Apple did that actually was the one that everybody wants them to do every time,
right?
Where they blow your mind away,
right?
And everyone
you wrote something about that.
Everyone before that, you know, was not like that, and everyone since then
like
has not really been like
that. The Cube wasn't like that,
no. Or even the iPad, which you know is arguably just as important to Apple going forward as the iPhone.
But I thought the iPad launch was actually kind of weird,
yeah,
and
was.
Somber.
Yeah.
And there was a period where Jobs was—I don't know if you guys remember—but in the iPad, the first iPad launch, he sat down and he was just browsing.
Right.
And there was like a long period where he's like, "Now I'm going to go check out the New York Times."
It was low key.
Now I'm going to look at Flickr.
Right.
Tap and go. It's just like that. Like him just talking about what he was doing, and he was just browsing.
Yeah. It was low key.
It was, and it went on for like 10
and
minutes.
And the reaction afterwards was there was an awful lot of, that's it? It's just a big iPod Touch.
Yeah.
Right?
Whereas
nobody
iPhone.
Was disappointed by the iPhone. I mean, the iPhone
right.
thing was, nobody was disappointed. Everybody was like, holy crap. You know, and famously, the RIM had a meeting like 2 days later where they like went over it and they're like, they must be lying. That's not possible. Right? I mean, that's... Somebody who worked at RIM claims that they had
but
that.
But the reactions from the industry, from other people right. in the industry around that launch were hilarious, right? Palm was like, I think I had a colleague who was like, you're not just going to come in here and make a phone. We've been working on this for years. Everybody was like, come
PC
on.
PC guys aren't just going
right.
to come right in.
Everybody's attitude in the right. industry who was making phones acted like, we're not worried about this at all.
Right.
And then in a couple of years, everybody was like, we are now going out of business thanks to the iPhone.
Right. Well, the Ed Colligan quote is one of my all-time favorites. Probably the most quoted thing I've done repeatedly. Just I should reblog it right now.
You should.
Just because
while
it's such
you're
a classic.
Sitting here.
It was right before, like a month before. It was like December 2006. Like a month before the iPhone comes out. Nobody knew what the iPhone was like, but the fever pitch of Apple's going to do a phone was at that point where it's like, well, they've got to do it now.
Right.
And Ed Colligan, that was then the CEO of Palm, said, we're not worried. PC guys aren't just going to come right in and
right.
whatever. But it's kind of interesting because, A, he was so
Ed.
Wrong.
So wrong.
But the most interesting thing is that he was wrong in a very important way, which is that the way phones have evolved since that day is that they're now computers.
Right.
There's no denying it that all the top phones are computers. They're computers that are more powerful than our laptops from maybe 8 years ago, 8-9 years ago.
Yeah.
And so you've got to be a PC guy. Could not have been. It was wrong not just that Apple was going to do well, but wrong about what it was going to mean to make a phone.
That they were always going to be these siloed devices that were meant to do one thing and not to do all this other stuff. So what's Apple like? Where is Apple now? Because, I mean, I think this is the question that everybody's asking. You can't deny that Jobs was this huge driving force. He wasn't just a salesman. He wasn't just a showman. He was intimately involved in the creation of those products.
Right. The question I get from a lot of people is their design going to go to crap now, or is it going to start slowly going to crap? And I don't think that's going to be the problem for Apple.
You mean like industrial design?
Well, across the board, UI design, industrial design, is the package for the next iPhone not going to be as nice?
Right.
I don't think you have to worry about any of those things.
I think that's the least. To me, that's the thing that I would imagine is least likely to happen, because they have designers in place.
And he wasn't even a designer, really.
Right.
I mean, he was like a director of designers.
He was like a dreamer.
Right.
And his job was basically to dream up stuff. I mean, really.
And if anything, I actually think their design might even get better without him, insofar as that there's no longer one guy, him, who, when he's wrong, can insist on having his way.
Do you think we'll see less or more stitched leather?
I think we'll see less.
Less stitched leather?
I don't think people laugh, but I think that that's Steve Jobs.
No, I agree.
Right.
I mean, I had heard a story from somebody in the industry, and they said, he's not really into the internet or computers. Like, he's not actually really that into the idea of computers as a thing. I mean, maybe it's not true, but I think that if you see some of his design, it does feel in a way like, let's get as far away from the concept of the computer as possible. I mean, I think a stitched leather icon is, you know, you're getting there. The ripped paper is, you're getting to this, like, don't make it, I don't want it to feel like a computer.
Right.
I think the
designers Apple has are going to do just as good, if not better, and they're still going to attract the talent. Where he's going to be missed is not on those details. Where he's going to be missed, or we don't know if he's going to be missed, but it...
Well, this is what I want to talk about. I
mean, is the big picture.
Right.
When do you do the big new thing? Right? So, like, the story of iOS basically is... And, you know, a lot of this stuff is now on the record thanks to Isaacson's book, but and other stories from the last couple of years. But long story short, they were working on a tablet in the mid-2000s and wasn't really there yet, but they'd gotten a lot of the touch stuff and they're working on it. And they wanted to make a phone because all the other phones on the market were crap and they had the iPod. And I thought, well, maybe we can parlay the click wheel iPod into a phone. And Jobs had this moment, and I really think, you know, this is the sort of thing that I think he was a genius for, is we've got this tablet over here with this touchscreen, and we've got this phone project. We're not near a finished product over here. We'll take this tech, put it on a phone-sized device, and that's going to solve all these problems we've had trying to get this phone interface to be good.
Right.
And then, 2-3 years into that, let's go back to the tablet. Now's the time to go back and take what we've done with the phone and go to the tablet. And every company that has ever tried to ship a tablet computer before the iPad, it was at best a dud.
Right.
You know.
But so what I'm saying is he's not there.
Right.
Those kind of like bursts of genius that led to products like the iPhone. Like, where are they coming from? I mean, I think the question is, maybe they've got the next 5 years of products in the pipeline. I mean, maybe they do. Maybe he dreamed up everything, or they collectively dreamed up these things that were going to be 5 years down the road. But Tim Cook is not Steve Jobs.
Right.
You know, and I don't think any of the people there, they're all geniuses in their own right, right? Scott Forstall is a genius, there's no question.
Right.
Johnny is a genius, right? All these people are super smart, but they don't have these kind of the eccentricities and the idiosyncratic like behavior of a Steve Jobs that's going to lead to some of this stuff. So is there this danger with Apple that they become a company that is just, it's like diminishing returns on what they're doing? I mean, so the next thing everybody's talking about is iTV. They're going to create some sort of home entertainment, solution. They're going to solve, in the book, Isaacson says that Jobs said something like, I cracked it, or I cracked the TV problem. I mean, is that the next thing? And if it isn't iPhone level excitement, do you think that the future is not as clear for Apple?
Oh, I definitely think it's not as clear. I think it wouldn't be as clear even if Steve Jobs were still around, though. I still don't know, you know, I don't think it makes it any more or less likely that we could predict what their next major initiative would be.
If Apple goes out of business next week, what does John Gruber do?
I would just keep writing about the most interesting stuff that I see.
That's a good segue to my next question, which is what are the other companies that are doing things that you like? I mean, what are companies that are... I would guess that if I asked you, is anybody executing the way Apple is executing, you would say no. I mean, I don't want to put words in your mouth. But are there other companies that you think are doing great things, that are doing spectacular things, that are innovating?
Well, who do you think is?
I think Google is. I think.
Yeah, but you know what? Google stuff, the stuff that Google does best doesn't really interest me that much.
I mean, but they do a lot of stuff that's really good. I mean, Android, I think, is really good in a lot of ways. I think it's different and, right. and better in some ways, in some places, than iOS. But different, and right. I think they can coexist happily. But, you know, when you look at their web offerings, I think it's hard to deny that things like Google Docs, Calendar, Gmail, the way they integrate, the way they live in the cloud, is nobody has pulled it off with such fluidity before.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, and the fact that people rely on it, you know, shows it. I mean, people are happy. I mean,
but you're hesitant. I feel like you're hesitant to say that they're one of the guys that are doing innovative stuff.
No, they are, but it doesn't interest me. It's not. It's just not my cup of tea.
But iCloud does interest you.
You know what? I don't really write that much about iCloud. I mean, I'm glad that it works, but it.
So web stuff is not that interesting to you.
Yeah, not really.
So let's take Google out. Microsoft.
I think so. I mean, I think Windows Phone 7 is really interesting. I think the whole Metro thing on the phone and on the desktop is definitely interesting.
Do they have an opportunity to come back from where they are? I mean, their market share in mobile is very low right now.
Yeah, and I actually think I've been thinking about this for weeks or months even, really, is this notion of traction in the market and how you can get it. And I think it's a mystery to anybody. I think it was a mystery even to Apple. I think it was like intuitive. I don't think there was a science to it. I don't think they really had exact numbers on you know, how many iPhones they were going to sell 2 years out. I don't think they were quite sure it was going to be as big a hit as it was. And I don't think anybody can really explain why Windows Phone 7 phones are selling as poorly as they are compared to other ones. It's very strange to me.
I think we had a boom of smartphones, right?
Right.
And the big winners in that boom were Android and iOS. And I think you've got to, like, at some point, you know, the market is growing, but at some point everybody's got their device from last year, they're not ready to move. I mean, I think there's certainly market forces at play there.
Right.
But it's got to be something more than that.
I don't know. There's something about it that doesn't seem right to me, though, because I think the worst thing anybody could say about Windows Phone 7 is that it's as good in most ways as Android. I mean, they're very different.
That's the worst thing they could say.
I don't see how you could say that it's really... I don't see how anybody could say... I could see how someone would say, I don't really care for the way it looks. I don't really like that. But, you know, I think if you took 1,000 people who travel back in time to 2006, where you've never seen any of these touch phones, travel back in time and get 1,000 people and show them an iPhone and a Windows Phone 7 and What's the Galaxy Nexus?
Galaxy Nexus.
Clearly the best.
My Galaxy Nexus.
Well, the best, but that's the
which
best.
I created.
The best Android phone to date.
I think so.
I don't think there's any doubt.
I think
about
it is. Yeah.
Because it's the only one with the ice cream sandwich, which is clearly a step up.
Yeah, and it's got a higher resolution
so
display.
Go back to 2006 with them and show them to 1,000 people. I think that you would find a very different mix of which phone those people would pick than what the market today looks like. I think a bunch of them would pick Windows Phone 7. And if you told them some of the things that it does, like the way that Windows Phone 7 works better with a Microsoft Windows PC, you know, just integrates with Outlook and all that stuff better than like the iPhone or Android phones do, I think that would appeal to a lot of people.
Right.
But you don't see that at all. I mean, they
right.
just have this tiny little slither of the market today.
My feeling is that the use of the word Windows in the name of the phone really hurt them.
Yeah, I think so.
I mean,
too.
I think if they had called the Metro, like, hey,
yeah.
we have these new Metro phones. Amazon, what do you think? Are they doing great stuff?
Oh, I think so. Yeah, Amazon's a good
You
great
like
company.
Amazon?
Yeah, I do.
Have you played with the Fire?
No, I haven't seen one yet.
You really?
No.
We got to get a Fire. You know, they're not that expensive. With that 25% bump from the jobs thing, you think you could afford it?
I've got so many gadgets piled up on the shelf in my office at home.
Don't talk to me about gadgets piled up. I'm living a true nightmare scenario. Facebook. You don't talk about Facebook a lot.
No. I don't even have a Facebook account.
Are they an important company? Do you think they're important?
Maybe. I think that they exist in the blind spot of my interest in technology. I've never seen the appeal of Facebook.
You don't like to be social.
I guess. I don't know. But I like Twitter. I think Twitter is
very social.
You do
love Twitter.
I just don't understand it. It doesn't. One of the things I love about Apple products, and I love about the way Apple designs things, is that it's very easy to get it. Oh, I get it. I get what you're supposed to do with this thing. That's why I like Twitter. When I first saw Twitter, it's like, oh, I get it. You get 140 characters at a time to make posts. And if you like what somebody else is Twittering 140 characters at a time, you can follow them. And if they start annoying you, you can unfollow them. And that's what you see, and that's the whole thing. And I was like, well, I get it.
You like that.
Right.
It's like kind of a single-use thing. I mean, it's very simplistic.
Right. Nobody can describe Facebook in a way that is that comprehensive.
It allows you to connect with your friends no matter where they are.
Yeah, but that's
elevator pitch. Huh? You're thinking about using it now, aren't you?
But that's not real. See, to me, the problem with that is it's not real.
No. Well, I guess that's true. All right. We need to wrap up.
I'll say this about Facebook. I do think there's something very interesting going on there with the talent acquisitions that they're making. So I would say I'm more interested in Facebook now than ever before, where they've hired
What acquisitions are you talking about?
They hired the Mike Mattis and the I forget who he was working with, but the guy who they did the ebook for Al Gore for the iPad and the iPhone bought the company, but then threw away all the ebook stuff they'd been working on. It was just a talent acquisition. They hired a company called Sofa, a Mac, and I think they did iPhone and iPod apps, but I know they did a bunch of Mac apps. Really, really exquisite, like Panic, you know, like Panic, mm-hmm. the people who make Transmit. Like that level, like even more painstakingly detailed user interfaces than even Apple does, type of independent Mac software. They bought Sofa, but didn't.
And so where do you think these acquisitions are leading? Do you have a theory, pet theory?
Oh, I don't know.
Phone, Facebook phone?
It could be. But they're buying people they're buying companies staffed with designers and engineers who can implement these exquisite UI design stuff. Like the stuff that wins Apple Design Awards.
Right. But on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being very excited and 1 having no interest whatsoever, where would you rank your feelings about a Facebook phone?
I would say...
You're supposed to say 1.
No, I would say it's actually high because I can't help but think that that's what they're hiring.
But you don't like the premise of Facebook.
I can't help but think that they're working on something that is new. That is not, I mean, I'm not saying it's not going to have ties to their existing social network, what we think of as Facebook. But I can't help but think with the talent that they're acquiring that they're doing something new. Because Facebook has like a certain look to it, right? Like, I've seen Facebook.
It's very ugly. No, it is. I mean, have you ever looked at it? It's not attractive.
But it's also consistently
ugly.
Well, I would say plain. I wouldn't even say ugly, but it's very consistent though. It has a look. Like when you go by someone in a coffee shop and they're on Facebook, you can see they're on Facebook at the corner of your eye.
Sure.
Everything looks the same.
I mean, you can't customize it like MySpace, that's true.
Right.
Unfortunately.
There's no way they're hiring people who make these exquisitely crafted UIs to make something that looks like that. Like I think that they're working on something ambitious.
Final question. Unfortunately, because I think we could talk all night. Is Apple going to do a TV? Is this happening?
I honestly don't know. I don't have any.
I need something.
I have
more
no inside dope
than that.
No, I don't.
I mean, does it seem like something Apple would do?
Years ago, I thought when they first did Apple TV and they unveiled it with a code name, they called it ITV, and then I guess they got rid of that because there's a cable network in Great Britain that has the name. And they said it was $3.99. It had a hard drive and you'd store stuff on it, and I thought, well, that's good. I'm glad Apple's getting into this. You know, it's nice to be able to use my iTunes account to buy this stuff. But why would Apple, a company that has always been very focused on selling high profit, high revenue items, why would they be happy selling a $200 box that you hook up to a $2,000 TV? Common sense tells you, why not sell them the $2,000 TV too?
Right.
And I think in the kernel of this whole rumor is that idea that everybody knows that that's true, that the most expensive thing in your living room entertainment is the TV set.
Yeah.
So why not sell it?
So why wouldn't Apple be selling the most expensive thing in
right.
your living room?
But it doesn't, it's a complicated story though, because everybody, people don't replace their TVs that quickly. I mean, I think people replace their TVs less frequently than they even replace their cars. You know, and if people, how many people, and the people who are most likely to get excited about an Apple TV when it's new, like an Apple branded television set when it's new, people, you know, who come to shows like this, are also, because they're nerds and gadget geeks and they like tech specs, most likely to have bought a pretty nice TV in the recent past. You know, and you're not going to replace
it. But not an Apple TV.
So my guess is if they're...
I mean, think about it.
Well, here's my guess.
If you knew you'd get an Apple TV, you'd buy one.
I don't know that I would.
Really?
Well, it would depend. My guess is that if they're going to sell TV sets, it would still be alongside a standalone Apple TV thing that you can hook up to an existing set.
Maybe it slides into the side, like a puck.
No,
in.
But I think something that
if you take it out.
A Panasonic, whatever, 55-inch, whatever, with HDMI.
Oh, so you think it'll provide the same thing? If they sell the TV, they'll have something that also provides the same.
Right, because I just don't see how selling the TV sets could get them a big enough market quickly enough, unless so, they're also selling boxes you can hook up to any TV set.
So I'm going to put you down as yes, they're going to make a TV. And we'll see if you're right about that. Boy, I'd hate if you were wrong. And on that triumphant note, I'm going to say thanks so much for being here. Really appreciate it. Give him a round of applause, everybody. John Gruber. And we talked a lot about Apple, and Paul Miller actually went to the new, you know, the new Grand Central Apple store. Have you been there?
No, just opened today, right?
Yeah, it opened today. But Paul Miller went a couple days ago. They had a press preview, and he shot some video. So take a look at this, and we'll be right back. Thanks again.
It may look like I'm in Grand Central right now, but I'm actually in an Apple store. And if you can see the hearts floating above my head, it's because I'm in love with the Apple Store, the world's largest Apple Store here in Grand Central. They have 350 employees. They took a whole wing of Grand Central. It was pretty wild. They had to work with the city. Like, this is hallowed ground in New York. And they just... Flash Bob. So when you visit an Apple store, it's always important to check what the current playlist is on the music devices, because then you know what's cool right now to listen to. Like, I've never heard of Azam Ali, but his album From Night to the Edge of Day sounds really incredible. I think it's a girl. Is that a girl? It could be a man or a woman, but it's blowing my mind. Oh my gosh, this music. So good. Just working on a song about how much I love the Apple Store. Let's see. I think it needs a little bit of vocals. Apple Store, San Grand Central. Oh yeah, oh yeah. So this is the accessory room, and as you'll notice, there's a lot of non-Apple products, which is why it's kind of hidden. It's kind of way back here. There's no windows, so nobody can see. But they're selling a lot of non-Apple products here. Which was left? Why does it say left? Someday these will all be Apple accessories, because Apple will own everything. It's a little prettier over here. It's a little less hidden like the accessories room. This is Genius Bar land. Two Genius Bars, so the highest Genius Bar per store capita ratio. I have a Macintosh SE. It has the dual floppy drives, not the high density floppy. And I'm trying to run Cosmic Osmo, which came on CD. Is there a way to add CD drive to the SE?
There is not on that computer.
There's no? So I have another phone.
Okay.
I'm trying to get Jetpack Joyride on here.
I'm not familiar with that.
But I can't find it on the store.
Well, I can tell you, I have little familiarity with this phone itself. Maybe
really?
You can tell me more about it. I don't even know.
It's the iPhone 3. I thought it was the iPhone 3G.
I can assure you it is not.
No?
The Samsung logo, to me, gave it away.
I thought Samsung made the iPhone.
They do not.
No?
But you know what? We still have lots of great options to get the 4S.
It's true. You know, I really feel like I'm coming around to the 4S here. If I'm learning anything from picking your brain as a genius, a certified genius, so I should get the iPhone 4S. Hi, are you guys in line for the iPhone?
No.
Are you guys in line for the new iPhone?
No.
No. If I just stand, so I can just start right here, or should I get behind you guys? Or?
Start right here? Line.
Okay, all right, thank you. Here's some first in line. Did it.
Adorable. That Paul Miller is just adorable, isn't he? You just want to put him in your lap and hug him. And maybe that's just me. I don't know. We should actually bring Paul and Nilay out to talk about the news and talk about the store. So please welcome Paul Miller and Nilay Patel.
Thank you.
Watch your step. God, it's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you get an iPhone 4S? Did you manage to score one?
No.
Really?
You told me that the Galaxy Nexus is the best thing ever.
So yeah, it's coming out on Verizon tomorrow. It's not true.
Yeah. Oh, it's coming out for Verizon? I think you're getting some bad information. So you guys know Paul Miller and Nilay Patel, editors, dashing.
Gentlemen.
Yeah. I think you're just telling me what you are.
Sailors.
Nilay's a sailor. So this store is massive,
yeah.
The Grand Central store. I mean, it's the biggest one in the world.
Yeah.
And they have two genius bars.
They took a whole wing of the Grand Central.
Does that seem excessive to you?
It's Apple.
So it has to be.
Do they have a train?
They don't have a
train.
That's
the one thing they're missing. It's no, like you can take the Apple Express.
They brings you, drops you off into the store. It's just
great.
A one line. That'd be great. That actually be kind of convenient.
It's called One Infinite Loop.
Yeah.
That's a little insider. Cute.
I think you just got booed, kind of.
I don't know.
And here I thought Gruber would get booed. It turns out it's Paul Miller.
What I did really like about the story is when you're in the floor of Grand Central, it's like, oh, I don't even see that there's a store up there. They're really subtle. But once you're in the Apple store, you kind of feel like all of Grand Central was designed and built for Apple's sake.
Yeah, no, that's how I feel about the world.
You feel like it was before Apple existed.
Yeah.
The guy who designed Grand Central knew someday Apple would exist.
Yeah.
And he built Grand Central as a shrine to the company.
He's like, people will buy phones here.
For phones they could, well, first off, phones, because they don't exist probably.
And people thought he was crazy. They're like, what's a phone?
They're like, what's a phone? And then, I don't know when Grand Central was built. It's probably like 1935 or whatever. There were definitely phones. So, and then, I'm not going to go down this road. This is clearly didn't happen. But will you?
Or
so we saw today, or did it. But we saw today the store was, it opened officially.
Yeah.
And there were hundreds of thousands of people.
I was here.
There were hundreds of thousands of people trampling each other to get into. What's crazy to me is people show up for an Apple store launch, and it's not like they've got new Apple stuff.
No.
It's not like they don't have the exact same setup and Apple stuff.
You do get a T-shirt. Often.
You get it. Oh, nice.
Oh, really? You think thousands of people showed up to get a free T-shirt? I guess it's possible.
But it's funny since you could like definitely go to Best Buy, like with a train. And be like,
You can't get the T-shirt there.
You can make a T-shirt. Come on.
Oh, you're going to make a T-shirt.
Not resourceful.
I think you're talking about pure fantasy at this point.
Or guys make T-shirts.
That's true. So not really very newsy, but it's kind of cool that they did it. But what is newsy today? There was some pretty huge news. I don't know if you guys have heard. HP made a big announcement. God, I want to ask Gruber about HP. Totally missed the window there. HP made an announcement. They're open sourcing WebOS.
Android is dead.
Hold on, any WebOS users here? There's got to be one.
It's like our staff.
One person, we put them in the nosebleed seats. You just can't win, can you? So HP's open sourcing WebOS, and they're going to still make tablets, they say.
I think they lied to you.
You think so? I talked to the CEO, Meg Whitman, and Mark Andreessen, who is on the board. And you think they both lied to me?
Well, you know, it's really interesting because their first announcement, kind of, they put up an FAQ that said, we'll evaluate. We'll open source WebOS, we think it's great. We'll evaluate it for future products, which is basically like, we think it's not very good. Right, and we'll see if it gets better when random dudes in their basement make it better for us because we failed to do that.
I don't think that means that. I think it means.
But they also said we're going to build the tablets in 2013, which is like we're going to take a break.
Meg said,
sucked at this for
Meg
too long.
Said maybe not this year, maybe next year.
What are
it's basically
do?
Already 2013 when you think about it.
Yeah, it's tomorrow.
I mean, look.
Close your eyes, Meg. Wake up. You can try the touchpad again.
Maybe she can meet the guy, the Grand Central guy, his time machine or however, whatever.
I think they hedged. I think they made the first announcement, we're going to open source it.
You know,
they were giving up, and they got the give up vibe, and they said, well, we're not going
to
give up.
When I talked to her, she kept mentioning how affordable it was going to be for them, which is not like a good necessarily good thing to hear when they're making a big decision. You know, like when somebody says, I got this for you, it was affordable, like you don't think, like, this is going to be great. Yeah. You think, like, it'll be good enough,
right.
I guess.
You know, when they bought Palm, and they bought WebOS. All they talked about is we have so much scale, we have so many resources. We're HP. We can do anything we want. We have all this cash. It's just it's in a box. Here you go, John Rubenstein. And they didn't do anything with it.
Where was John Rubenstein today?
He was like, yeah, nowhere, right? It was Meg Whitman and Mark Andreessen who were basically not there when they bought Palm.
Right.
And Mark Andreessen famous for what? Netscape.
It's the new face of WebOS.
Yeah, the guy
Meg
who did
and
Netscape.
Mark.
And the lady who ran eBay.
Mozilla. I mean, there's wins there.
Are you using Firefox today?
No. I would not touch
open
Firefox.
Open source win, right?
I am a Chrome user. Well, oh, another great Google product.
Yeah.
Gruber. By the way. Another killer. I bet you're interested in browsers. Where is he? I don't know who I'm talking to. I'm like scanning the audience.
Exactly.
Gruber's just like walking around up there.
He's a presence that haunts us.
Yeah,
think,
really.
Daily.
It's haunting. A haunting presence. But I don't know. This just feels like...
This is the end of the line.
I just feel like this is like really great for the like homebrew guys.
Mm. Yeah,
no, like WebOS internals are going to be so psyched.
And the WebOS internal guys, they were already putting up pictures, screenshots of like the Evo 3D, like running hacked builds of WebOS. Like TC in our office, who like still has a pre, was like super excited because it was WebOS on real hardware. You know, and that's great. That's great for those guys. I mean, this is what Mego. They killed Mego with WebOS, right?
Given this, I mean, you're a lawyer. Given the open sourcing of WebOS, does this mean that if Matias Duarte wanted to, he could take cards?
He already did.
Put it in, no, but like real cards and put it into Android.
I don't know. They didn't say what license they're going to do. Well, it could be a totally restrictive license.
I mean, Mark said to me they want to completely open source WebOS.
I don't know what that means. There's all these levels, right?
It's pretty straightforward what he said.
No, but that's like, that.
I mean, it seemed to me like WebOS in its entirety in terms of like as an OS.
But actually, that's not what they're doing. They said we'll do WebOS right now. We'll do Enyo later. Enyo is like the big application framework, and then we'll do the rest of the user space later. So there's three steps. They're saying.
Yeah. What he was saying is there's parts that need to be tweaked so they can be open.
Yeah, you need to finish them.
Yeah. Like we left that. The email client. Should have finished that.
I think that this is the end of the road for WebOS as a product. I think we'll see a bunch of like maybe Chinese phones with it, like other companies that want to build it into things. Maybe Google can take some of it and roll up some of the, but I don't think they need to. They have Matias. They have the brain behind WebOS, right, working for them.
Right.
And I think he has new and different ideas. And I think if you're a creative person, you have new and different ideas.
Yeah, put
ideas.
The cards going up and down instead of across.
Side to side.
Completely.
So they'll donate it to RIM. They're like, look, you already took most of this.
No.
Just finish the playbook with WebOS.
Oh, it's dark. It's dark. Very dark. My
around.
Love affair with Palm is over. It died a long time ago, really.
Wow, this has got really sad.
It started
really fast.
It started beautiful. You know, it really was like all relationships. There was hope.
Yeah.
That it would go on forever.
And then they cheated on you with HP.
They left me.
They left
me for HP.
And then
HP messed them up bad. And when I went, when I saw them again, it wasn't the Palm that I knew.
No.
Moving on, CES is coming up. And, you know, it's December in January, CES 2012. We're the official tech news partner, which you may have heard. It's pretty exciting. Sure. Feel free to applaud at length about that. But we should talk about predictions, CES predictions. Let's go down the line. Paul, what do you think will be happening at CES?
Well, I'd like to quote somebody else's prediction. Eric Schmidt said in 2012, the majority of TVs...
He said this when?
just a couple weeks ago.
Okay.
The majority of TVs are going to be running Google TV in 2012.
He was drunk.
Or high.
Very possibly both.
You know, I talked to Google about Google TV a few weeks ago, and they're very high on it. You know, they're like, you know, we've really made some strides.
Maybe you guys don't know. Maybe at CES, it's going to be every TV is going to
have Google TV. Well, it would be wild and crazy because currently there are so many different smart TV platforms, and like every other TV now can tweet or check Facebook or something, but it's all completely proprietary, and it would be great if it's standardized, but Google TV was any good.
Yeah, you know, I think the problems that John Gruber was talking about that are like, nobody's going to buy a new TV. It's not Android where everybody needs your phone every year and you go and get one, and there's only one operating system that like is a good competitor to the iPhone. It was Android, so everybody went and used it. I don't think TVs are like that. I think people want to turn on their TVs and watch television.
I don't think so. I'm not so sure about that.
I know I turn on my TV and I'm like, can I check Twitter?
Yeah, that's the first thing
using
I think.
Using a giant
I have to do
remote.
An update. I have to update Facebook right now. Yeah.
How many clicks on the arrow keys?
No, you're right. People want to watch TV, and that's why everybody has cable.
Right.
But I mean, that the whole idea, right, is that everybody wants cable to come to a close in some way. They want to, like, go around it. Maybe. I mean, I'm talking about myself now, basically.
Well, you want to go around your cable box.
I want to go around my cable
company.
But
you don't want to go around, well, because you have Time Warner. Everybody wants to go around.
It doesn't matter. Look, you go to any city in America, except where you can get Fios, but go to any place else, and everybody will tell you about how horrible their cable provider is.
Yeah.
Comcast cities, Time Warner cities.
Yeah.
I can't think of any others right now. Because that's all there is, because it's a big monopoly.
Well, two. Yeah.
A duopoly.
But,
I'm
you know, I think what it is we'll see this explosion of televisions. You know, we saw a bunch of smart TVs last year. Last year was supposed to be the year of Google TV, and they all pulled out of the announcement.
So wait, you didn't even say what your prediction was. Is it televisions?
My prediction is there's going to be a million smart TVs, and I would be really interested to
see none of them will have Google TV.
Some Google TVs.
All right, what's your prediction?
And it's Android related too. I think we're going to see the second wave of Android tablets, the second real wave. There's been this like minor wave, like, oh, look at these 7-inch ones.
It was more like a light surf.
Yeah.
Now this is going to be
this is like the
tsunami,
a boat
tidal
like
wave,
by, right? And it was like a
but I think a jet
we'll
ski.
See jet ski, yeah, jet ski wave. That's what it was.
Yeah, like the one 7-inch of those little, you know, yeah.
I think we'll see, and they'll be really cheap. I think they have figured out that they can't compete with Apple at $499, and they need to go to $200. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where you're going to see a lot of action from all these companies, because that's the only way they can do it.
I think, you know, we talked about this earlier. I think there's going to be we're going to see a lot of Ultrabooks.
Lots of Ultrabooks.
Right. And
that's all Joanna's going to do.
I just wish there was going to be, we're going to hear a lot, I think a lot more about Windows, probably Windows 8. I mean, Microsoft is doing their keynote. We're going to hear a lot about Windows 8. And I have a feeling that we're going to see a lot of tablet people with like Windows 8.
Like ARM tablets?
Yeah, ARM tablets. Or maybe even Intel stuff. I mean, there could be both. Mm-hmm. But I think Windows 8 is going to be all over the place. I think that's going to be like this year's Android is Windows 8. Am I crazy?
I mean, maybe. It depends on how much Microsoft wants to show, right? How much they've made the decision.
Well, I mean, there's a dev version of Windows 8 out there. There's no reason why Asus can't come along and throw it on a tablet.
Asus is crazy.
They're talking about a public.
They'll do anything.
Do whatever they want.
A public beta in February.
Right.
So they've got to have something to show. But
right.
Microsoft is really good at disappointing people at CES.
That is true.
You know, actually, and so is Intel.
Yeah,
like combined.
Intel too.
Like, I bet Intel will probably show a phone that they'll never ship.
Android phone.
That's like their main move.
Yeah. They love to do
Dell
that.
Dell will wake me up at 8 in the morning to go and like.
They're
going to
show you like a wood model.
Here's the Adamo 3. We've got it out for 10
Look
seconds.
Look how thin this is.
Yeah.
This is a piece of balsa wood with Adamo written on it.
I do feel like the one time I was really surprised and blown away at CES.
Both surprised and blown away.
Yeah. Was WebOS.
Yeah. No, that was
the one
WebOS. I don't want to get back to Palm. Don't take me down this dirt, because that was when my love was reignited.
It's just because a lot of CES stuff feels really inevitable. It's just re-upping the last year.
I mean, WebOS and the pre was like a magical experience.
Yeah.
We can't keep talking about this. Anyhow, we were talking about Microsoft, and on that note, I would like to show you guys something that we did. We went to Microsoft. You guys have already seen a little bit of this. I went to Microsoft to their campus and looked at some of the research projects that they're working on. And it was a pretty interesting trip. So take a look, and we'll be right back. I never thought I'd see this with my eyes, with my eyeballs. I figured I'd have to get implants to see it. Building 92, there's 91 buildings before this. It's pretty amazing. Hey.
Hey, Josh.
Steve, how are you?
Good to see you.
So this is Steve Clayton. He's going to show us around the campus and take us into the dark, deep chambers that no one else is ever allowed to see,
That's
right?
Where we're
That's
going.
What you promised me.
Welcome to Microsoft.
All right, let's do it. I'm excited that I can get like a cloud computing shirt, t-shirt.
That's your color.
It's my size too, small, lady small.
What you need is some golf gear.
Yeah, do you have golf gear here? Balmer is a golfer, right? Does he golf or no?
I think so, I've not played around with him.
Are you allowed to refer to him as Balmer?
Steve.
Is that against rules? You can't say
there
Balmer?
You go. Look, golf mate.
Yeah, but it doesn't say Microsoft on it.
I'll bet it does.
No, it doesn't. Look at this line. What are the savings like? Wait a second, this is a line for Zunes?
Yeah.
What do you mean? No, but is there any special reason why there's a line for Zunes? And now they're back in stock. Zunes are back in stock at Microsoft and there's a line. This is insane. This is probably the only place where you'll see a line for Zunes, actually, which is... They're going to kick us out? Now, this kind of makes me want to buy a Zune, though. I might get in this line. How much is the 64? This is a visitor center. This is designed just to kind of show off what you guys are doing.
Yeah, it gives a little sense of
how
bit of the history of where we've
Microsoft
come from.
Microsoft invented the typewriter.
Yeah, I'm
you
not
invented
sure.
You invented the Atari. You got a General Electric things. Television. Are you taking credit for the GE television? I feel like that's somewhat disingenuous.
My job is to work with all of the kind of product groups, all of the research teams across Microsoft who are looking at trends like natural user interface and social computing and cloud computing and sort of help to tell the story of what Microsoft is doing across 90,000 people.
Where are we right now?
We are on main campus for Microsoft in Redmond in Building 99, which is the headquarters for Microsoft Research worldwide and the location of our Redmond Research Lab.
Hey, so who are you guys and what are you working on?
So I'm Brandon Lloyd.
How are you? Nice to meet you.
I'm Nikon Jagvanchi.
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
And we both work in the Extreme Computing Group. It's a kind of a lab within Microsoft
Extreme
Research.
Extreme Computing?
Right.
Do you drink a lot of Mountain Dew?
This is a simple mobile augmented reality system. So we have this image and the cameras on the tablets that you see here, and we've got this one fixed on the tripod. They are tracking that image.
So this is tracking here, mm-hmm. and then you guys are tracking individually on these tablets.
Right. By finding this image in the video feed, it can figure out where the camera is in space. And then once it knows where the real camera is, it can render virtual objects from that same point of view and then overlay them on the background.
Okay, so you guys have another mode on here that's called Connect mode, and we brought Steve in to help us out with this. And can you explain what's going on with this?
We hooked up a Connect camera to this, and what we're doing is we're capturing whoever sits in front of the camera in real time.
This is disturbing.
So this is kind of a different kind of video chat.
All right, let me try this out. Let me get a...
There he is. Spin him around.
It is, I feel like... This isn't right. People shouldn't be allowed to do this.
At the Kinect camera.
You want me to look at where?
Yeah, look at the Kinect.
Here, okay.
Okay, and then we'll freeze it, and now you can come and explore yourself with the tablet.
That is something I enjoy doing, so... Oh, wow. This is very upsetting. Very upsetting. This is horrific. I mean, this is a true horror. This is like a scene from a Saw movie. So we're making our way through the Microsoft campus here, but we're gonna stop and take a look at this anechoic chamber they've got where they do sound testing, they test webcams there, and it's supposed to be pretty cool. And I'm hoping I can get maybe a little nap in if I play my cards right. Hey.
Hi.
Hey, how are you? I'm Josh.
Good. I'm Dale Sieg.
Oh, thanks. Thanks for letting us come in here, Dale. And what are we gonna look at?
So we are going to look at one of our anechoic chambers here at Microsoft.
Wow, this is really disorienting.
Yes.
This is it's kind of making me a little nauseous. Is that normal?
It depending on the person, it can be. And so if you guys get
I can barely hear you.
Is
that normal? That's normal.
That is normal.
Am I passing out? What if I just passed out right now? Has that happened before?
That has not happened before.
Has anybody freaked out from this?
But we've had to escort people out really quickly. So we test all of our acoustic products, obviously, so our webcams and headsets. The Kinect was tested in here. We actually also test non-acoustic products, like for our mice and keyboards and other devices that have some mechanical characteristics that might generate a sound. we'll put them in this anechoic chamber so we can actually characterize the sound and identify if it's a buzzing or a hum, where the sound is coming from, that sort of thing.
Okay. Have you ever come in here and discovered Steve Ballmer asleep, taking a little, stealing away a little nap and had to wake him up?
No.
Really?
Not yet.
You can tell me.
No, I have not.
You know, when you think about it, with the lights off and this no sound, be kind of like sensory deprivation.
Yes.
You know, can you imagine what you'd see in that pitch black? Yeah. Everybody gets very uncomfortable with Ballmer jokes around here, I have to say. Every time I mention Ballmer, people are like, I can't to comment on that. It's like he's listening, watching. You know, so I've thought about it. Could I go in here and just stand in the dark in the chamber?
Sure.
Okay, yeah. Great. Oh my God. Wait a second. I might actually be having some kind of vision. I'm seeing Steve Ballmer napping. This is amazing. This vision of Steve Ballmer, I mean, flying. This is really cool. We're in the Microsoft model shop. This is where Microsoft's actual products are designed and built. We're talking to Carson Agard, who is your model maker here.
Yes.
And so if a new Xbox were coming, if there was a new version, mm-hmm. which you can tell me if there is, it's no
okay,
problem.
I will.
So what are we looking at here? You've got a table full of...
We're looking at basically a variety of what we do down here, broken down to everything from raw 3D printed parts to some CNC parts.
This is a 3D printed wrench that you printed in one piece.
Correct.
And you can use it like an actual...
Yeah, so that shows the ability to be able to print multiple parts together as an assembly.
So we're here with Young Kim, who's one of the designers who worked on the Arc Mouse, which is a kind of an award-winning, pretty big product as far as mice go.
It all kind of started with nothing more than just hair bands and foam core, where we were playing around with pieces that bent and flexed.
So you have to take this up to Ballmer, right, and say, look, this will work. You don't go into his office.
We didn't check in with Steve Ballmer this time.
He doesn't approve all the early mice designs?
No, that was my understanding.
He trusts us
to make the right decisions.
Okay, good. Yeah. That's good. I really need to get something like this or this because I'm using like an old, every time I reach into my bag, there's like a ball there.
Yeah. What kind of mouse do you have?
Yeah, it's one of these guys. This is like a classic. It's a classic mouse.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Have you ever seen anything this advanced?
I think someone as stylish as you are, I think, deserves something like this.
Well, that is shameless flattery, and I appreciate it. But you know what's cool about this is actually, I don't like big mice. And this is a little bit, it's a little bit bigger of a footprint, but it feels almost non-existent when you're holding it in your hand, which is great.
And the fact that it, you know, folds flat so you can put it in your pocket.
Awesome. I mean, this is just disgusting. This is sick and spade. You have a hammer? Get it, get the hammer. Let's go. This is, very strong. Surprisingly.
Pretty strong.
Logitech is gonna love this, by the way.
Yeah, there you go.
By the way, you have to sell or give me a mouse now, okay?
You don't have a mouse now, okay.
No, I don't. Well, hey, thank you so much for this. Really cool.
Thank you so much.
That, don't you want it? I just totally destroyed my mouse for no reason. And I still don't have a mouse replacement. Here's the really shocking thing. I discovered right after I smashed my mouse, which is a Bluetooth mouse, that the Arc Touch has a dongle. So it was pretty upsetting. You guys are probably wondering why Joanna Stern is standing next to me, the lovely and delightful Joanna Stern. Give her a round of applause. So you know, Joanna's kind of our resident Windows laptop expert.
I am.
And I recently expressed a kind of a dislike for Windows, which was just haunting me. I said Windows feels like poison to me on a podcast. And it really was affecting to a lot of people, a lot of Windows fans. And Joanna got this idea that she could provide a better Windows experience for me.
That's what I'm hoping.
And well, we were talking about this and she was telling me, okay, well, if you get a laptop, here's what you need to do. And I thought people are going to get these for the holidays. They're going to get a new Windows laptop. And it's going to have stuff on it that they're not going to like.
Well, they'll have some stuff that they do like.
Yeah, sure. No, I understand that. But it's going to have like bloatware.
Absolutely.
And you have kind of like put together a little guide to how to make your windows.
Yeah, deep poison windows.
To deep poison, the antidote.
Yes, I'm hoping after this you are going to be using Windows.
I'm going to be a full-time Windows user.
Windows user.
Anything's possible. So let's walk through.
Yeah,
what would you do?
We've got a few different steps here. So this is a Samsung right out of the box. Hopefully we're getting that there. And one of the big problems is crapware. You mentioned it before.
Yeah, I hate it.
Litters the whole system.
Have you met anybody who's like, you know what I really like? Crapware. I like a computer to be really bloated when I get it.
I bet actually this company that makes this software likes crapware because they wouldn't have a product.
They wouldn't have a business.
They wouldn't have a business.
Coming at it from a different angle.
Yeah. So Slim Cleaner is the first thing you probably want to put on your system. And you can actually select different programs.
By the way,
here.
Slim Cleaner is not paid for an advertisement.
Yeah, no. Never.
Joanna just thinks it's a good tool.
I just found this.
And this basically will find bloatware on your computer.
Exactly. And what's actually interesting about this is like me and you, we know what to delete, right? We know like, well, oh, we probably should get rid of this wild tangent games.
What I do is I just erase
everything.
Hard drive.
And put on something
else. I put it away.
Okay. Well, some others in our audience know what to delete. So what you can actually do here is you can see reviews of things that people like said, oh, yeah, you wouldn't want this. And you can come in here.
Yeah, because they're actually crowdsourcing. So on this piece of software, people will basically tell you this is a you want to keep this piece of bloatware.
Right, and there's comments. Really people leave comments.
But you know, the thing is you have to be careful because like the Bing bar, for instance, 91 people said we like this.
Well, I bet at Microsoft a lot of people like
that. No, I mean, maybe it's great. I don't know. I'm just saying, maybe you don't want the Bing bar.
I personally don't want the Bing bar.
Right, there you go.
But, so that's one way to do it. You could obviously also come into the control panel here.
This is a little bit nerdier to actually just go find the application.
Exactly.
And delete it by hand.
So like, you know, and then there's the step, the major step.
This is the sledgehammer.
You buy Windows 7, you install it.
Yeah.
You get rid of everything.
I think that's what I would do. That seems easier, but it's like, how much is it?
$120? Yeah, $120.
So that's like the sledgehammer.
This is going to cost
the,
you.
The doing it on your own is the scalpel.
Yeah.
And then what would you call the Slim Cleaner is like something in between. It's like a rusty knife.
Yeah.
One of these, doing one of these moves? A gun.
A gun.
It's a gun. Okay.
It's a gun.
All right, so I've taken the bloatware off of my computer now.
Crackware removed.
Thank you, Trent.
It's good.
So this one here, you might want to get rid of sort of the generic Windows desktop. I think that might be what you don't like about Windows.
I'm not crazy about. I am like, it doesn't strike me as particularly beautiful.
Okay, you know, maybe like you don't like the icons all on the left side. You like them on the right. Maybe
like
you want to add a sort of a widget type of thing.
So this actually looks really nice.
Yeah. So this is really cool. I've used two different things here. One, I changed the desktop background, which is
great background. You should always great choice.
First thing you should do: change the desktop background. Like this one has HP logo on it. So the other thing I did here was I installed Rain Meter. And Rain Meter actually lets you, it's sort of like a Launcher Pro, like Android Launcher Pro for Windows. You can put widgets up here. I've got a battery. I've got a time. And you can customize all these things. You can put I've got the Verge logo, or the Verge feeds coming through here.
That's good.
Over here you can, I'm using something called Fences where you can organize all your desktop icons.
So these are just aliases to apps. Do these Windows snap?
These don't snap in place, so you can move these around.
Well, how do you get things perfect?
You line them up.
By hand.
With a ruler.
You get put a piece of tape on the screen.
That's
great. I feel like snapping would be a really good feature here.
It would be.
Yeah. That's just one man's opinion though.
It actually seems to like sort of lock in place.
So
but
it
I
is
don't
snapping.
Know if it's snapping, but it's
and what
not
is
like,
it, and what is that called?
This is called Fences.
Okay. So Fences and Rain Meter.
Yeah.
Again, not paid endorsements, just things we like.
Just software that we like.
And then on this one, on this computer, which by the way is obscenely ripping off
awesome.
A MacBook. I mean, no.
Does your MacBook have this?
No, we saw it. I wish it had a Beats volume control.
This is the new HP Envy for
the setter. Gruber showed it to his kid backstage and goes, look, Jonas, a ripoff. Which is amazing.
I mean, this is freaking shameless. I mean, they should be ashamed of themselves.
You have this Beats audio thing?
This is disgusting, okay? I mean, how come Apple isn't suing HP?
That could happen.
I mean, to talk about IP, IP ripoff. Nilay, can we?
Oh, I'm on the case.
Yeah. You're going to do handle this?
Yeah, no.
Okay,
so
great.
Back to Windows.
But let's talk about what's happening on the screen. So,
yes. Right here, I think Windows has gotten sort of a bad rap for not having very good-looking apps. I think people sort of figure Office, you're gonna have, you know, Outlook, all that sort of stuff.
Right.
And so here's some
ribbons everywhere.
Ribbons everywhere. So this is a few apps I like. This is MetroTwit. It's really nice looking, sort of looks like a Windows 8 or a Windows Phone 7
app. Are you following Tom Cruise?
Yes, I am.
I didn't even know he had a Twitter account.
He doesn't, you know, I really should unfollow him.
No.
No,
I need to
really
find him,
much.
So just keep following him because I need to follow him.
He doesn't tweet
I need
much.
To find out what's going to happen with Ghost Protocol. Is it going to be cool or not? Okay, so this is basically like, it's basically like a Twitter client, Metro-style Twitter client.
Exactly. Okay. Looks very nice.
What else?
Maybe you want to use it.
Maybe. What is this?
Maybe.
What?
These are some, this is an email client. I wanted to find you an email client that you'd really like.
What is wrong with you?
Ross emailed me this.
Ross emailed this
to you? My good friend Ross. So I wanted to show you the GIF support, the animated GIF support.
That's
here.
That's great.
But no, this is an app called Postbox.
Right.
Comes for OS X as well.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's a nice, it's not the perfect Gmail implementation. I wanted to find that for you.
Yeah.
But it's a good one. You can get labels in there.
Yeah, you have also these little applets.
Yeah,
what
these little
this?
Applets in here. So these are a little app called Pokey. And so you can install these down here to the taskbar. And you can actually just like sort of reply from in here.
Are you replying right now?
I'm going to reply to Thomas Houston right here.
This is great.
So you don't actually have to go out to the to the browser.
So these are little applets, little
yep.
wrappers.
And all are free.
I have to admit, I mean, I feel like this combination is somewhat compelling.
Yeah, look at this desktop. Look how nice it is.
No, I see it. Yes, all clean. You have the third one too.
Yeah. Application installed.
All right, so.
So you're going to use Windows now?
No. I mean, so if I was, I think there's a laptop in mind that you. What would you recommend for me?
This one, you seem to really like how
this
it looks.
Is great. This is great. I won't have to get
I actually haven't
used
tested
to a
this
new
one
look.
Yet. Yeah. And look, and then remember?
Beats. That's great.
I would suggest, and I think I've got it over here.
You do.
And this is the Lenovo IdeaPad U300S.
We were talking about this before, and I have to say, like, as far as, and this should be, you know, HP should take a look at what Lenovo's doing. Because, you know, there are some similarities, chiclet keyboard or whatever, to a Mac, but I mean, every computer has this now. But this is actually, the industrial design of this is really nice.
I really like the design. I don't, you will miss the backlit keyboard, no backlit keyboard, but.
Well, that's
maybe the next one.
I mean, that's an outrage.
I know.
And this is a Core i3?
Yeah, you can get a Core i7, Core i5.
All right. I mean, maybe I'll do it. I mean, maybe you've shown me the light. I doubt it, but I mean, it's possible. I will say that this is a much better.
This desktop looks good.
Yes, it looks very good.
I know. I'm trying to.
All right, here you go. Thank you very much. Joanna Stern, everyone. Depoisoning.
Try it.
Put that down there. We actually have a word from our sponsor, believe it or not.
Who's our
sponsor?
Sony. Okay.
And we'll be right back with some very interesting thoughts from Nilay Patel. Stay tuned.
Hi there, I'm Amy.
And I'm Nick.
And we're Carmen. And we just wanted to say how excited we are to be a new member of the Sony family.
From signing with Epic Records to being part of the new Make.Believe marketing efforts to releasing our first single, Crash Your Party, we can't wait to see where this new relationship takes us next.
Be sure to watch out for our new video and discover the unexpected at sony.com/experience.
Sony.
Make.Believe.
I am also happy to be part of the Sony family. And I'm excited about my new album, which is dropping in the fall.
When you make Dot Believe, what do you wish for?
I mean, what don't you wish for? All right, so as you can see, Nilay is standing over here, and I'm sure you're wondering, why is Nilay standing over there? You know, Apple and Samsung have had a lot of disagreements recently about patents. Apple feels Samsung has infringed. Samsung denies it. There have been motions, dismissals, motions to dismiss. I'm just listing
lots
court terms
jargon.
Now. I don't really understand what any of this means.
Legal jargon.
But recently, Apple made some suggestions in a court document to Samsung about how they could alter the Galaxy Tab to make it look less like an iPad. And Nilay has gone to work with our crack team of legal experts and designers and put together how he thinks Samsung might get away from this Apple design aesthetic they feel is happening.
Yeah, you know, Apple has some of the best designers on the planet. They've got a very aggressive legal team, I think you all know. And, you know, they also have a registration on the iPad. They think the Galaxy Tab looks too much like the iPad. And it's kind of true. I mean, we can just bring it up here. I mean, which one's which, right? So they made a lot of suggestions to the court. Running Android is Galaxy Tab.
Probably.
So they made a lot of suggestions to court, and they're pretty reasonable. And we sat down and tried to think about how you would really implement this. So the first one, pretty basic, don't make it black. Use something other than black in the front. So we went with kind of a classy dark red.
So Apple said in this court document, don't make it black. I just want to be clear, don't have a black bezel.
Yeah.
So you're suggesting
kind of
a burgundy.
I think you really want to step out, right? I think you want to go like pattern.
Like a Pinot Noir.
Yeah, I think this is, I think it's really solid.
You take it further here.
Yeah, well, I mean, you look at that, I think, well, you know, maybe Johnny Ive had a little too much.
So you're saying go from a red to a pattern, that'll differentiate.
A little bit, but they also said, well, the bezel, you know, it still kind of looks like an iPad. So they said, well, make the bezel smaller. And I think we all agree bezel sizes are too big. Samsung has a really great processor, dual core Exynos in there. They've got LTE radios. We want to highlight that kind of stuff. So let's shrink the bezel. Let's show you what's inside the Galaxy Tab. Let's really sell it. So that's great. I think, you know, you'd still might think, well, you know, Apple's proud of their internals. Their next suggestion was don't have horizontal speakers, right? And you can see why. You know, you've got this all plain front, speakers on the side. And we thought about where do you put the speakers? Where do you really enhance the sound quality of the tablet? Because what you're watching a lot of movies. So we went with a triple stereo front placement, center channel.
I'm sorry, triple stereo?
Yeah, it's 3D.
Is that how many? I mean, that's left, right, and what's the other one?
Yeah, the middle one is just it's your center channel.
Center
for vocals.
Triple stereo.
Triple stereo.
Okay.
The middle one's when you turn your head.
Yeah, you turn it sideways in stereo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Reasonable suggestions.
Yeah, but you still think, well, you know, it's got an Apple vibe to it. I think we can all agree. So how do you really differentiate it? How do you say, well, you know, Apple's kind of this like, you know, latte sipping kind of nerdy guy. You want to spice this thing up. We had some texture to the front. Apple said, don't make the front flat. We put some spikes on it. We make it really stand out, make it really aggressive. We just looked at my bracelet.
Hey, I was going to say, was there you guys took a trip to Hot Topic.
We scanned the bracelet, and we put it right on there.
Is that a handle?
Yeah, the handle
looks
really
good. Yeah, the handle's great.
I like
it's
that.
It's useful.
It's nice.
But then Apple said, well, it's still too thin, right? I mean, that was actually a suggestion. Make it thicker. Apple products are known for being really thin. And so if you're going to make it thicker, you don't want to just go halfway. You want to really, you want to push it. You want to know that you've got the power of Android behind you. So we went all the way. Just as far as we could. And I think this is a place where if you had 80% vision, you would stop. You would say, this is fine, we did enough.
This is really good now.
This is a Motorola move, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, this is where you stop.
This is strong.
If we really want to stand out, you know, Apple's last suggestion was we have a patent on rounded rectangles, right? But you don't want to square them off. You don't want to make them too sharp. You don't want this, right? You want something organic, something natural. And so we thought about it a lot. We spent a lot of money on designers, and we came up with this, the new Samsung Galaxy Tab.
Very nice. That's very nice.
I thought so.
I mean, call me crazy, but I still feel like they're kind of infringing here.
Yeah, no, it's obvious.
I feel like it's
bigger
a little
spikes.
Bit iPad-like still. Yeah.
I don't know which is which, to be honest.
Yeah, which one again is the Samsung?
That background looks familiar.
all right, I think it's time for, I think we should do new thing. Let's do new thing. We're not really good at doing new thing.
We're terrible.
How is it you sit on the stool again?
I think you lay on them.
Oh,
thank
look
you.
At that. So, as you guys may or may not know, we're doing this thing on the show where we talk about something that we're really into right at this moment from the world of technology. So we're just going to do that. We're adding Joanna to the mix, which is exciting.
I don't know, what are we doing here?
I feel like her pick is really strong. So we're giving, what do we have, 15 or 20 seconds on the clock?
I think it's 15.
No, I think it's, is it 20? It's 20. Last time it was 15, and we thought that we needed that extra 5 seconds.
It was 30 in rehearsal.
Yeah, we brought it further down. So we're going to have 20 seconds to talk about the thing that we like. That we're into right now, and I guess like we're just gonna get the countdown here, and I'll start. Are we ready? Okay. Okay. Yes, my new thing is the Galaxy Nexus. So, as you know, on the last show, Matias Duarte was here from Google, and we talked about it, and I stole it from him. I beat him and stole it from him. No, I finally got to play with it. I have a review in it, which has to be sent back, unfortunately, but I'm probably going to buy it. As soon as I get done with this, and that's it. That's all I have to say. Okay, it's your turn. Yeah, you have to go.
This is my new thing. Come here.
Come here. You can't
yes, this is my shark. He's an air swimmer. You can buy him for $30. That doesn't include the helium. You got to fill him up with helium. And then he comes with this and he can wag his tail. He's getting too far.
And how much? $30?
$30 just for this. No helium included.
What a deal.
But usually it works. Come on, work.
Oh, my turn. My new thing is the Pico Dolly, which looks really cool. It is a piece of metal with wheels. I'm very, very fond of it. It rolls. It takes really awesome video. It makes all of our videos on the site look great. And Chad bought one, and I stole it. So it's mine now. I'm very, like, it's the coolest thing. It's $100.
Here's your chance, Chad.
It's a Kickstarter project, right? Kickstarter.
All right, Paul, go.
So this week on eBay, I bought an eMate. For $30, actually.
What is an eMate?
An eMate is Apple in the 90s made a laptop using the Newton operating system. It has a stylus, but it actually almost looks a bit like an iMac. It's got that sort of translucent vibe. But it's the early netbook. And I'm going to use it to write the great American novel.
Oh, the great. Very nice. The great. I just want to note the great American novel, not a great American novel.
No,
the
ultimate.
It's all over after Paul.
Only one that's
did you take that early netbook thing as a diss, Joanna? Because that's like your.
He was kind of directing it to you.
I mean, I can get you a good netbook for $30.
Is it a ViewSonic?
Yes. it doesn't have a screen.
So it has a stylus.
We're almost wrapped up here. We have one more thing. We have a couple of giveaways that we want to hand out to some people in the audience. You don't have to come down and get it. But two people here are going to be leaving with a... really?
Jordan?
With a Transformer Prime. That's great. So we have two ASUS Transformer Primes to give away. Joanna just reviewed this. She really liked it a lot. It's a Honeycomb tablet. Android 3.2 right now, but it's going to get Ice Cream Sandwich very soon. Right?
Yep. They say now early next year.
What just happened? Okay, yeah. That went perfectly.
The screen is really excited about it.
So anyhow, so we're going to grab some, Paul and Nilay have some numbers here. Do not rush the stage, all two of you. I hope it's the WebOS guy, really.
Yeah.
He deserves it.
Matt, that's not you. Did you move?
I have a touchpad.
Oh, no, that doesn't really count.
So, row C, seat 120.
Row C, seat 120. There you go. All right, congratulations. Man. All right, Nilay, second Transformer Prime.
Row D, seat 10. You have done it.
Right here.
You have survived.
Oh my God.
Wow, that guy.
Wow.
Are you holding up Windows logos?
Are they Windows logos?
What are you? No, are those balloons?
From the Gizmodo Gallery before.
Really?
Yeah. You did not win.
Wow. Very nice.
You can pick them up after the show.
That's awesome.
We will pop your balloons later.
anyhow, that's our show. So, House Band Trent, can you play us out?